Okay, come on and get going.
Hey.
Ready?
Yep.
You want to go
back? Go back.
You guys killed it. This thing is insane.
So he just tapped this blue button here.
Whoa!
Right?
Dan, I have to interrupt you here. That's the coolest dashboard I've ever seen in my life. Welcome to a very special feature about an insane car that we built for this guy, Mr. Travis Pastrana. Welcome to the studio.
I'm excited to be here. I'm excited to have this car in front of us too.
This car is absolutely nuts, and it's based off of that thing right there.
A little bit different, but it's still a wagon. And I feel like that's the coolest part is kind of doing a throwback to say, man, this is kind of what made Subaru. I mean, back, you talk about the US ski team back in the mid 80s, and it's so much nostalgia to this vehicle. Plus, it's a lot easier for me in that it's a little bit shorter car.
Yep.
I can see the corners of it. So when we're trying to get proximity, stuff that you don't think about as a racer or as you're driving is how close you can get the back end. And the last car, the Gymkhana, the Air Slayer, it was amazing.
Yep.
So much downforce. The wing was so far back, I kept thinking, I'm like, where's the, just trying not to take it off.
Is that the face you were making?
Yeah,
throughout
the whole
thing?
Time, scared.
That car last year was incredible. The Air Slayer STI and Gymkhana 2020.
Well, set all the records. That car was made for Mount Washington, and it did its job. It was absolutely, it was thrilling, death-defying, and scary to drive. This car equally as scary, but it just makes you giggle when you're driving a wagon.
So without further ado, we're gonna go into all the detail, all the little nitty-gritty stuff that I know you love talking about.
The Asteroids Machine is calling my name from the game room. I'll see you guys later. Have fun with that.
So we're gonna talk to Bill and Dan from Subaru that are gonna walk us through this insane machine, AKA the Gymkhana GL wagon. All right, so joining us today, we have Bill Stokes from Subaru Motorsports USA and Dan Anktel from Vermont Sports Car. Bill and I started talking about this thing with Scotto and Travis and the team while Air Slayer was just being finished. We were like, we want something throwback. We want something 80s. We want something boxy.
Yeah, and we really didn't want to do something that was similar to the Air Slayer because, we had just done it. So we started looking at ways that we could kind of do something different, kind of out of the box, or maybe more in the box, I guess, because it is really boxy. But yeah, we wanted to do something that wasn't a WRX or an STI, because that's like the sort of standard Subaru performance thing. We wanted to say, take what we learned from Air Slayer and then put it into something that nobody expected, but was still very iconic as a Subaru.
You guys killed it. This thing is insane.
These guys killed it. I mean, Vermont Sports Car did an incredible job executing kind of what the vision was and what we had sort of laid out as the concept.
Absolutely, and that's the coolest thing to me. I mean, having had the privilege of seeing a bunch of race cars, rally cars across the world, WRC spec, FIA World Rallycross, those cars are built to the highest standard of off-road, well, rally-style racing. And in Vermont, there's a shop that kicks out that level of quality, or in this case, to me, just looking at it from here, even higher. I mean, it's incredible what you guys have been able to do this thing. So for the people, what's it based off of?
So the shape and the body is kind of based on a 1984 Subaru GL wagon, but specifically maybe the most quirky and weird out of all the wagons we did back in the 80s, which was the US Ski Team tie-in cars. And those were done for a few different years, so they spanned a couple of generations. Mm-hmm. But like the early 80s wagon was really what we wanted to replicate. And that's like this iconic red, white, and blue color scheme, which is awesome for Travis loving the red, white, and blue and everything. So we just wanted to take kind of the spirit of that 84 GL wagon. We wanted the four square headlights, and we wanted the boxy body style and the short overhangs and everything. And we wanted to just translate that into something that had all the crazy performance that we had in the Air Slayer, but that 84 was the body style that we kind of landed on, and the Ski Team livery and look and style was what we wanted to replicate.
Overall, broad specs, what are we looking at? We have Subaru Boxer 4, 862 horsepower, all-wheel drive, single turbo, sequential gearbox,
all carbon, the good stuff.
Everything.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the chassis. Let's start getting into this thing a little bit. Obviously, that shell is not gonna take anything that Travis is gonna wanna throw at it. It won't take anywhere near, I mean, 862 horsepower, that's like almost eight times, let's say seven times what that thing makes. So obviously you guys need to base it off of something a little safer and stronger. So what is the inside? What's this based off of?
So what we've got going on here is a vehicle that has minimal overhangs for an engine, for a vehicle that has a boxer engine, right? And that is absolutely key for Travis and his proximity driving, okay. Right? So front, rear, super efficient for the sliding. Like Bill was saying, you've got essentially what the Air Slayer is, 2.3 liter engine, big Garrett turbo, anti-lag, the works, right? Sequential box. Additionally, we wanted some active aero still. So we'll show you here in a minute, but bits of this car that just look like as you see it, pop up and suddenly you've got aero and wings, and then you can bring it right back down. And that is all driver controlled, right? So it's pretty awesome.
The coolest thing to me is that this kind of looks like if that raced DTM in the 80s is kind of what this is. And like DTM back then, it was a space frame type chassis, and just based off of what I can see from the outside, there's no unibody shell at all. Like, what's this chassis?
Yeah, correct. This was all 3D modeled, right? So it's not based off an original car. This is all tube frame and carbon tub work, the whole thing, which was all specifically designed for the geometry and the sliding and the angles that we wanted, right? In addition to that, the cage is actually the latest spec WRC cage. It's a dual hoop cage. Built into the chassis for strength and safety, which is absolutely essential for the amount of crazy stunts that we've done with this car. So, you know, we want to make sure Travis is safe, and we brought that forward, and we're super happy with the outcome.
We are too. I mean, this thing looks incredible. And the thing that pops out to me right now is that this is a race car with a roof rack, which is absolutely sick. But I don't know, from my eyes, I imagine the Vermont sports car isn't just going to slap a roof rack on. So what's going on here?
So the radiator, like the rallycross car, is in the rear, okay? So you've got a lot of airflow coming around here, and the actual intake for the radiator is on the roof rather than on the side where the Air Slayer was. So airflow was essential, so why not use a roof rack to help direct some airflow in and out through the back? So that's what we've got going on up there.
Yep. God, that's absolutely sick. We're gonna have to throw some skis on there. And then I see there's some seams going on around here. What's happening with that?
Yeah, so the active aero, you've got your four corners, right? So these corners on each side pop up, and then on the rear, same idea. And then also, doesn't look like it, but this extends here. And this is all driver controlled. I'll show you in a minute how that works. But everything here is active and whatever Travis wants, and it's all independent of itself. So he can do the front, he can do the rear, he can do the roof.
I had no idea.
Everything, yeah.
That's sick.
Pretty amazing.
It's crazy to evolve that, because we had active aero on last year's car. Yep. It's just the rear wing.
Yep.
The flap came up.
Yeah, so we can program it. He can do it on a button. We can do it based on speed. We can base it on braking. Anything you could want to cater it to the stunt and the speed that he's going. You know, we mentioned 862 horsepower in a six-speed sequential box. It's geared for 175 miles an hour. That was not even in the Air Slayer.
That's wild, because yeah, we topped the car out on that country road jump that we kind of engineered that spoiler for. Yep. 175.
Yeah.
Dude, that's great. 175 in a shorter car.
Yeah, so the wheelbase here, front to rear, is actually within millimeters of our car over here.
Wow.
But the width on your body is about a foot wider, just to fit, you know, drivetrain and components and whatnot.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You end up with your awesome boxy flares, that DTM look, to fit it. One thing that I'm super proud of with Vermont Sports Car aesthetically is all the tie-ins, you know, working with our partners in KMC Wheels in Yokohama to the original car. So these wheels, although they're 18s and those are 13s, the spoke design
and the dish
is meant to be pretty similar.
That's
right?
Really cool.
Like Bill was saying, the front headlights and whatnot, same design, but so difficult to get original parts, right? So 3D printed in-house Vermont Sports Car, these corners.
No way.
Yeah, so that's a clear 3D print there.
And you even got the lines and the exact design and everything.
The devil's in the details, right?
Yeah,
just
absolutely.
make it work. So it's super nice, super clean, functional, all of it lights up. A lot of these small just details like bumper guards, like the original car, but these ones are carbon. Yeah. You know, door guards along the side here, carbon. You just stand here, you just kind of stand back and look at this build, and it's so clean.
There's so many layers to this onion that you start diving in and looking at. I mean, I love the wheels. KMC made that homage to the original wheel, obviously a bit wider, wrapped in the Yokohama AO52s, which that's the tire we used last year.
Tried and true.
Travis.
Yeah.
Same width, fixed, same everything.
It ain't broke, don't fix it.
Yeah.
Go with it.
It's amazing. And what I love about that is it's a tire that anybody can drive. Because we were talking about, you know, Gymkhana, you need that. You can't use a race tire for it. You want that progressive brake.
Yeah, the race tires are designed for that heat transfer and they'll grease up. So this, you know, these tires, which are based on a road car tire, you gut the grip and then you can overcome that grip and create the smoke when you want it. And then it grips back up when you come off the throttle a little bit.
Right.
So they're just it's the perfect combination that you're looking for what we're doing.
What should we dive into next? I mean, I kind of want to see, well, let's go around the back real quick.
Yeah, we haven't done the back yet.
You're making an 80s car. You gotta have louvers.
I mean, this is essential, right?
Yeah.
Just the look alone.
Yeah.
And then modern splashes. I mean, look at this rear diffuser. It's absolutely gorgeous, all carbon.
Yeah.
Direct that airflow out. And then you've got carbon, 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 and then you've got original tail lights. These are actually original to a car we found. We bought a number of these cars all around the country to kind of pick and choose what we wanted.
So these taillights came off of somebody's car you guys got off of Craigslist.
Yeah.
He has no idea.
No idea.
God, that's incredible.
He'll know now.
Yeah.
And then, you know, other hits like the original Subaru logos.
Okay.
These are 3D printed to make them look nice, and just so many small details that are so accurate.
Even like the little four-wheel drive turbo. One of my favorite things about 80s cars is that they would advertise all of their features to you. All-wheel drive across
dual
the side of the door.
Dual overhead cams.
Yeah. Dude, crazy, DOHC on every DSM we've ever seen. Yeah man.
Yeah.
I those little touches really do it for me. Well, I want to see inside of this thing. Can we take a peek?
Yeah, let's open her up. Everything we've been discussing on the outside, the Easter eggs and the small touches, carry through to the inside.
Okay.
Right? You may or may not notice the interior of the original cars had kind of that bluish hue, right?
Yeah.
Like in the seats and whatnot. We carried that forward, and items like your dash here, which is carbon, is a blue carbon weave. It's just absolutely beautiful.
Oh my God, you can actually see that.
Yeah, so in the right lighting, you just kind of see it flutter a little bit, and it's got that blue in there. Everything is identical with a modern touch. It's just, it's absolutely beautiful. And then it's all, you know, the functionality there for Travis and what he needs to do is integrated into these original buttons and switches, which is just, you know, it's just next level. It's so nice.
Speaking of switches, I mean these.
Yep.
Like the original 80s, like multi-function twist knob switch.
Yeah.
You guys put a factory one in
there. Yeah, put the effort in, right? And instead of just a flat carbon dash with no features, let's
like
make this
dusty
something.
Flocking.
Yeah.
That used to be okay.
Yeah.
But I mean, the level that these Gymkhana cars are getting to now is like, how can you keep one upping? So I see we have the traditional kind of sequential shift lever.
Yep.
But I also see a paddle on the wheel. What's the paddle got going on?
This was something we came up with a number of years ago from the racing program. That's push to talk. So spotting for Travis and whatnot when we have communications back and forth. And then you pull it and that's your wiper, right? So you can hold it, you can just one touch it and it actuates the wiper. So we've actually seen a whole bunch of teams integrate that into their race cars.
Hmm. We got the air kit, of course.
Yeah, well, when you're doing tricky stuff around water, it's all about that safety, right?
Always, absolutely. One thing I'm kind of noticing right now, this carbon is super thick on the doors. I mean, obviously still, this door weighs nothing. But it's like, is that a more rigid carbon you guys use? Is that derived from Rallycross? Or?
It was via a partner that's helping us with a lot of the carbon work with our scheduling this year, with racing being so heavy. We went with a supplier on a number of the carbon components based on our designs. And this is what they came up with. It was a little bit stronger, a little bit thicker, just to make it work. And they do beautiful work. It's really nice.
I love that little detail.
I like slamming the door too, just like the Hoonicorn. It's got that original kind of feel.
Clunk.
Like it just, you know what I mean? It's got a great sound to it when you shut that door. So.
And it shuts. It's it's not like most race cars where you just gotta center punch.
And we made such a big deal at the last filming of the build bio for the other car, is just like the seams and the gaps, everything just, you know, lining up and looking nice. Like you said, you're not lifting and hitting with your hip, you know.
So many race cars are 20 footers. You start walking up and you're like, oh, okay, that door is completely off.
Yeah.
God, you guys are worried about panel gaps on this thing. Like that's wild. Yep.
Should we power it on?
I would love to. I'm gonna come around the other side.
So you just tap this blue button here. You'll see the screen come on.
The
original logo.
Kind of
fades in and out.
Whoa!
Right? So, essentially, we've had this whole thing programmed to capture the functionality of the car and different aspects of it and give it that old school flair on the screen.
Ben,
so, super pumped.
I have to interrupt you here. That is insane. Look, race car stuff, whatever. That's the coolest dashboard I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
Like, hands down.
It's probably my favorite part of this car. And this little screen here is fantastic. This highlights what you're activating for aero on the car. As you touch them, okay, so you would only activate the front. Then you're only activating the rear. Then it's all four, the wing. And it's all right here on a touch button.
God, that's so cool. And that was one of the things that I remember looking at GLs. Some of them had these really cool, like almost peak 80s, like LED, like little screens here and there, four-wheel drive system, center diff, all that stuff. You guys took those designs and that 80s vibe right down to the colors and the designs and the fonts and everything and made it into this like full, almost X-Wing style display.
And then there's other small things like this canister, right? That's the air bomb.
Right.
That's so for the aero, you have this electric pneumatic pump and it's always creating pressure that sits in this tank.
Sure.
Right? And then so that's how you're popping up the aero and then it's coming back down.
While we're in here, can you activate the active aero?
Sure can.
Dude. That's nuts.
Ready again?
Sure, yeah. God, that just sounds industrial.
It does. And some of the fact that all the aero is active on this car was one of the things that Travis had requested, because the old car had a lot of static aero on it. So there was a lot of stuff sticking out of the bodywork. The downforce was always there. So it's actually fairly difficult to drive a car that has a lot of downforce all the time, because as soon as you start to go a little bit sideways, the downforce is
gone. You lose it all.
So you have tons of grip and then you have no grip.
Interesting.
So this car is more focused on just having consistent grip all the time. So you have it, you lose it, you can kind of control it as you want to. But then when we need to fly the car, we've got front aero, a couple of different rear aero options, and it's all customizable, as Dan was saying, so that we can test different jumps, different speeds, and we can figure out what the aero balance needs to be, and Travis can execute the jump, but then the aero isn't getting in the way for the other stuff that we're trying to do.
Can we, can I see the flaps?
Dan, do you want to do the honors?
Okay. There it is. I'll go down there.
It never gets old. I mean, we've seen it a few times now, it's awesome.
It comes down slow. That's kind of rad, too. So I'm sure I'm torturing most people because we want to take a look at the engine bay.
Yeah.
But right before we do, this? Are you kidding
yes.
me?
Yes. Yes.
Most just chop it, square tube, DTM style, old school race exhaust.
It's the 80s. We had to go square. Because the Air Slayer had the chimneys coming out of the hood.
Yeah, straight out the hood.
And it had the 3D printed STI logo and the Inconel tips and everything. So we basically said, okay, you know, what can we do to kind of translate that into this shape?
Sure.
And So we boxed it, and we've got the old school logo in it. And as a result of the fact that the exhaust comes sideways out of the engine bay, mm-hmm. this thing is way louder than the Air Slayer was because
really?
You know the noise was going up with the old car. This one is going directly into your ear. And we got also the you know the heat protection on the fender.
Oh
which
yeah,
is really nicely integrated, and that's
right because you don't want to be melting livery off.
Right, and yeah, that's the kind of thing where like it's so nicely integrated you don't even notice it, and then wait a second, you're like, oh, that's a.
You know, it's
a beautiful piece of metal there, just as protection.
All right. Well, let's take a look underneath the hood. Get it down to here, so you got to get it from
more,
around.
There's more connections here.
Oh, wow. See, I don't know if you guys watch our content, but we kind of have a thing about hoods flying off of cars.
Not going to happen here.
That's not going to happen here. Wow. Sorry, do you mind? Can I take a quick look at this? Look at that detail. This is so nice.
Try not to scratch it. Okay.
You got the exhaust on you?
Yep. Coming my way. There we go.
And off we go.
Oh my God. Wow. That's super clean. Super clean, living just in a sea of carbon and tubing and billet, everything. Wow.
And the thing I love the most about it is that with the Air Slayer, with the Rallycross cars, which had a similar kind of engine package, you know, you kind of open the hood and lift it off like a conventional car. With this, the clamshell, you can see everything. You get so much more of a view. You get the tubs. You get so much more of the exhaust that's visible. You get the intercooler up front. You can kind of look down into everything. And obviously, the radiator's in the back, but you can see so much of what's up front here. And it just puts all the work that Vermont Sports Car did to create this thing out of the vision that we'd originally had. It puts it all on display, which is perfect because it's so well executed.
It's just so clean sheet engineered. Mm-hmm. Like everything plays with everything and makes sense with everything. Like even this little flap, which I imagine is just bringing more air into your fans.
Yep.
The engine itself, this is similar architecture to the previous.
It carries over essentially
Okay.
Yeah. So with the Air Slayer, we did play games with what we were doing with displacement and whatnot between 2 liter race engine from RX or, you know, 2.3 liter for Gymkhana.
Right.
This is the 2.3 liter basic, not basic, but certainly what we have been using for Gymkhana stuff before. So,
right. EJ base block?
EJ based, Boxer 4, 2.3 liter, Garrett Turbo front mounted on there. You got your intercooler, your airbox, divorced wastegate, so it's separate from the exhaust flow out the side there.
And is it it's a billet block, right?
Everything's billet. So you've got a billet block, billet heads, bespoke design for the intake here under the carbon there.
Mm-hmm. This motor's a workhorse. I mean, Gymkhana, flying finish. Tire testing, all the things that we did with that old car and the motor never came out. I mean, that's, hey, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And this has the no head gasket magic.
I got in trouble for that one. So let's.
that got a lot of comments last time.
It did.
Time.
Well, everybody says, oh, wash the head gasket, you know, well.
He figured out a way.
But it's a common thing.
Sure.
O-ringing a race engine like that, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Is something you do.
It's
a normal
And I think
thing.
The reliability of the engine is, I mean, that's because of the fact that it comes from our Rallycross program. So the fundamental architecture of this engine, even though it's not the 2.3 liter version, the 2 liter we want to run in Rallycross is so heavily tested and validated.
Right,
and it's had
right,
so
right.
much engineering and development put into it because that's what you need to be competitive on a global level in Rallycross.
Sure.
So to do Gymkhana, I'm not saying it's easier, but it's not the same level of torture testing over and over and all of the hard launches that we have to
that's
put
fair.
It through. So it allows us to take some of that, the experience and the engineering that we've gained from the Rallycross side and put it into the Gymkhana
Very
product
cool.
again.
What are we revving out to?
What is it, 9,000, Simon?
82.
8,200 RPM.
Yep. And it lives there liter. A lot of the time.
yeah.
you know?
Yes, it does. And I see the anodized purple, so on Ryger suspension?
Ryger suspension, yep. Also derived from the Rallycross program with some tweaks for Gymkhana driving, but it works.
And yeah, I mean, this thing has the suspension travel of one of your rally cars.
Right.
So that means this thing droops way out. So when we're doing jumps and everything, it can be super mellow, give Travis a nice cushy landing.
Right.
Give the chassis a little break.
Right. And Travis and, you know, he's famous obviously for the rallycross jumps from Nitro Rallycross and like those big 90-100 foot gap jumps. But we actually do some farther jumps in rally, in ARA. Like for example, the best known jump in the rally side is from Oregon Trail Rally, and that's like 120 feet or something like that. So we've got a lot of experience in jumping, and all of that goes into the suspension that's on this car.
The hood just comes off in one giant thing really quick, and that's almost like a hood and an integrated fender.
Total access instantly.
Yeah.
As soon as you get it off, yeah.
And the rest of the bodywork is replaced just as easily, I imagine?
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, we head to the rear comes off at the same kind of feel to get to all the ducting in the rear.
Really?
For the radiator and all that. So yeah, I mean, if we want to head back there, we can.
Yeah, I would love to take a look at all the cooling system in the back.
Thanks, boys. So, like we discussed earlier, you've got your airflow coming in from the top, right? So your airflow off the windshield wants to come up, so it's gonna hit this, it's gonna stay low, and then you can see there's a little bit of a spoiler built in the underside of this.
Yeah.
Right, it's kind of like that rear vane on the back of the STI.
Right, right.
Just up here. So then you're directing your airflow down through a rear-mounted radiator for all your cooling needs, and then just right out the bottom. There you go.
Right, because just as important as feeding it air is having that.
Yeah,
hot
well,
air
you've
exit.
Got an you've got an angle layer on the radiator, right? So just that straight shot airflow right down and out the back is absolutely key. And then it's a pressurized system, so you've got your header tank essentially, which these valves allow us to adjust how much pressure the system's running for efficiency, and that's another race car thing.
Sure.
And then obviously you can see all the look at the carbon tubing in here, all the wheel wells, the floor. It's all perfectly integrated into the tube chassis and the cage design, which comes down through, goes down through the floor, becomes your subframe, you know, with bolts that come up through.
Sorry, I'm just taking in every little detail. I mean, right down to these little support Heim joints right here, the full carbon body. Bill, Dan, congrats, because this thing is bananas. Like, it's one of the craziest and most detailed and most just beautiful race car builds I've seen. And it's an 80s wagon. Can't go wrong with that. Yep. Like, big props to VSC and Subaru Motorsports for putting this together. I'm blown away, genuinely so. So I just geeked out on this thing for like 20 minutes. I know you couldn't stop snapping pictures of it when you were in here.
It's a wagon. Like, how cool is that? I mean, it's like the most badass wagon ever built. It's amazing.
So there you have it. That's the car that we built just for Gymkhana with Subaru. Actually, Subaru built it. We had nothing to do with it. Enjoy it in Gymkhana coming up. Date right here. Don't miss it. I'm gonna watch it. You should watch it. Have a watch party. This guy's gonna watch. Well, you did it.
Yeah, I mean, I experienced
now you get
it,
to watch
but now I get to see what I messed up.
And, exactly.
Yeah.
So
how close I came to dying.
Don't miss it.